In this video, I'm going to introduce some basics of MapReduce. Till now, you have seen how to interact with HDFS, how to read and write files from HDFS. Now let us see how to process the files which are already present in HDFS using MapReduce. Let us get started. So MapReduce is a system that is used to process the data in Hadoop cluster. What we do is, to process the data, we write two Java classes. One is a mapper. I'll show you how to write a mapper class. And another is reducer. I'll later show you how to write a reducer class. Mapper will contain some logic and reducer will contain some logic. Then while processing, what we do is we create a jar. We create a jar out of all our classes and submit that jar to MapReduce engine. So you already know in MapReduce engine what are the demos which will start when MapReduce engine starts. Job tracker, task tracker, you remember, right? So once I write a mapper class and reducer class, I'll create a jar and submit this jar which contains the MapReduce job. So MapReduce programs will contain two phases. My program will be executed in phases, map phase and reduce phase. Let's assume a simple scenario where I have a 640 MB file. 640 MB file means how many blocks? Each block size by default is 64 MB, right? So there will be 10 blocks present on different data nodes. So what happens is, one map task will process each block. So if there are 10 blocks, how many map tasks will be created? 10 map tasks. Each map task operates on one HDFS block by default. After map phase is completed, then the output of all mappers will be given to reducers. We say that reducer phase will start. And between map phase and reduce phase, there is one more stage called as shuffle and sort. Let me explain you the process by using a simple example. Okay, so let us go ahead. I'll show you a basic example. I have a simple file, sample file, employees.txt. In reality, in production, we'll be processing huge files in gigabytes and terabytes or even petabytes. But just for our understanding, I have taken a sample file which contains few lines. So actually this file is containing some employee data. Each line is containing one employee data. First one is employee ID, date of birth, name of the employee, gender of the employee, salary, and the department ID or the department number to which he belongs to. Each employee may belong to different departments. So like that, I have all the employee details here. Now what I want to do is, I want to write a simple MapReduce job which will compute the sum of salaries of employees belonging to each department. So I want an output like this. I want the output to be something like D005. In D005, how many are there? Here is one and here is one. 25,000 and 10,000. So it is 35,000. And D007 is present how many times? Only one time. So D007. 35,000. And D004 is two times. So D004, 40 plus 30, 70,000. So after my MapReduce job is executed, I want an output like this, which shows what is the department number and the sum of all salaries of all employees belonging to that department. So with this example, let us try to understand what a mapper does and what a reducer does. I'll show you the code a little later, but let us try to understand the logic conceptually at higher level now. Now, this file is a very small file. Assume that the size of this file is, say, 150 MB. So I will show you by using a simple diagram. Assume that this is my cluster where I have some 4 slave nodes and 2 master nodes. Okay, 2 master nodes. 1 minute. Okay, so my cluster is containing 4 slave nodes and 2 master nodes. This is master 1, I'll say, master 2, slave 1, slave 2, slave 3, slave 4. Now assume that on my master 1 there is job tracker daemon running, and on master 2 there is name node running, and on all these slave nodes data node daemons will be running and task trackers will be running. Assume that here task tracker 1, task tracker 2, task tracker 3, task tracker 4, 4 task trackers are running. Now I have a file, say employees.txt, which is of 150 MB, assume. Okay, which is of 150 MB. Now, how many blocks will it be in? By default, the block says 64, so it will be divided into 3 blocks, B1, B2, and B3. Let's assume that B1 is present here, B2, and B3, 3 blocks. Now, what I want to do is, I will write a map reduce program. So I'll be writing one mapper and one reducer, and I'll be creating a jar. So I'll say my job dot jar. I have created a job, map reduce job jar. So what I will be doing is, whenever I want to execute a map reduce job, I will use Hadoop client. Through Hadoop client, I will be submitting my map reduce jar. So whenever I submit map reduce job, my Hadoop client will talk to job tracker and it will submit the map reduce job to job tracker. Okay, so before a map reduce job is submitted to job tracker, what my client also does is, it will create input splits. It will create input splits. It will split this employees.txt into various input splits. So what is this input split? Input split is a logical object which represents one block. So there are 3 blocks. So how many input splits will be created? Input split 1, input split 2, input split 3. So input splits 1, 2, and 3. Input splits are logical objects. They do not contain any data. Remember, blocks contain the actual data and input splits are the logical objects for each block. So if there are 3 blocks, there will be 3 input splits. Who will create these input splits? Hadoop client. What information does this input split contain? This input split will contain what is the location of the block, corresponding block. What is the byte offset? From which byte is this input split containing? Is this block containing data? And this block is present in what all hosts? By default, the replication factor is 3, right? So this block 1 might be present in 3 hosts. So what, where all are these block locations present? So all such information will be present inside input split. So we say that input split contains the block information, or one input split is a logical equivalent of a physical block. The block will contain actual data, but logical split will contain all the information about the block. So Hadoop client will create input split objects. How many input splits? If there are three blocks, three input splits. And along with the job jar, the input splits also is given to job tracker. Now the job tracker, what it will do is, by looking inside input split, it identifies this input split belongs to which block? Block one. Where is block one located? In slave one. So what this job tracker will do is, it will create a map task. It will create one map task out of the mapper. My jar is containing mapper.class, right? So using that mapper.class, a map task will be created. Don't worry, I am talking about all this at conceptual level. We'll dig deep into it later once you understand this high level things. So my job tracker has got three input splits. For each input split, one map task will be created, and map task will be given to the corresponding task trackers. So B1 is present in S1, slave 1, and on that task tracker 1 is running. So the input split corresponding to block 1, the map task corresponding to input split will be given to this one. So the job tracker will create three map tasks and give it to the corresponding task trackers, which are running on the corresponding slaves. So that means the map tasks will be working on data local to that slave node. Is it? Yes. Don't you think that the map tasks are executed parallelly? Yes, on three nodes, the map tasks are executed parallelly on local data. Then the output of mapper will be a key value pair. Output of mapper will be a key value pair. So one mapper will emit one key value, a lot of key value pairs. So in my case, if you see for this file, for each line, it will emit the key as the department number, and the value is the salary. So my mapper may output some data like this. So each mapper may output the data like this. So map task 1 will output, so say D001, salary is 25,000. And map task, same map task may output G005, whatever the value for each line. So for each line, in this case, my mapper will be emitting key as department number and value as a salary. So like that, each map task will work on a corresponding block and will emit key value pairs. So let me just show you. Assume for this case, the first map task has emitted D001, D005. Second map task may emit D006, 40,000. Just for example, I'm giving D001, 20,000. D001, 10,000. D005, 20,000. Like that, second map task may emit some key value pair. Similarly, third map task also will emit. Now, once all the map tasks are executed, then the reduce phase will start. So what the job tracker will do is, it will schedule one reduce task by default. By default, there will be only one reducer. Of course, we can set how many reducers we want through our configuration. We'll see that later. But by default, if you don't specify anything, there will be only one reducer. So reducer can be started on any of the task tracker. Who is responsible for executing the map tasks? Task trackers. Who is responsible for executing reduce tasks? Task trackers. So the job tracker will decide which task tracker has to execute this reduce task. It may be any of the node. Okay. So assume that reduce task has been started on this task tracker 4. Now the output of all these mappers will be transferred to this node, and the reduce task will work on the output of all these mappers. Okay. So reduce task will start only after all the mappers are executed. And even before starting reduce task, let's assume that the mappers are executing. The task trackers will be sending the heartbeats to my job tracker. In that heartbeat, the task trackers also will be sending the information about the task progress. What is the percentage of the task completed? How many records were read? All such information will be sent to job tracker. Who will be sending? Task tracker will be sending the task information, the progress of the map task or reduced task to job tracker. Okay. So once all the map tasks are completed, then only reduced task will start. We'll say that map phase is complete and reduce phase starts. But before the reduce phase starts, there is one more phase in between map task and reduce task. That is called as shuffle and sort. Okay. What happens is during shuffle phase, there are a lot of key value pairs. All the key value pairs whose key is same are aggregated at one place. And the shuffle phase, what it will do is it will make the key value pairs like this D001 for this key. Okay, the values will be list of 25,000, comma for D001 20,000, comma 10,000. A list of all the values. D005, it contains what? A list of 30,000 and 20,000, right? And D006, there's only one key value pair, but also here it will be list of all the things, 40,000. So the shuffle phase will make sure that the key value pairs whose key is same are aggregated together. Okay. And it will create again key value pairs, one key and list of all values for that key. After shuffle phase is completed, then sorting is done based on the key. So all the key value pairs will be sorted based on key. Then for each key value pair, the reducer will be executed. So reducer will be given the aggregated data for each key. So between map and reduce, there is shuffle and sort. So this is a high level explanation about what a map task will do. Who will start map tasks? Can you tell me? Who will run the map tasks? Job tracker or task tracker? Task tracker will run the map task. But who will assign the map tasks to task tracker? Job tracker will assign the map tasks to task tracker. How this assignment will happen? What are the various algorithms behind this assignment? We'll see that little later. So job tracker will assign map tasks or reduce tasks to task tracker, and task trackers are responsible for executing the tasks, either map task or reduce task. So where are the map tasks executed? Map tasks are executed on a machine where the corresponding blocks are residing. Each map task will execute on one input split. Input split is equivalent to one block, logical equivalence of one block, right? So one map task will be executed wherever the block is residing. So for mappers, there is data locality, right? That means mappers will execute wherever the data is residing, wherever the block is present. But is there a data locality for reducer? No. reducer will not work on local data because we don't know where is the local data present. So output of all the mappers will be copied to the node where reduce task is scheduled. Okay. So this task trackers will be sending heartbeats to job tracker, and these heartbeats will contain the progress, and the progress is reported to the client by the job tracker. So this is a flow of a simple map reduce program. So let me continue. I'll open my presentation and I'll continue my discussion. So we understood about map phase, reduce phase, and shuffle and sort at a high level. Coming to features of MapReduce, automatic parallelization and distribution is done by MapReduce. Don't you think that map tasks are executed parallelly? So if my file contain 10 blocks, how many map tasks are started? 10 map tasks. 10 map tasks, don't you think that they are executed parallelly on different nodes? Yes. So MapReduce supports automatic parallelization and distribution of the jobs. And another important feature to be discussed about MapReduce is fault tolerance. Assume that there are 4 slave nodes which are running. And let's assume that your file is containing blocks, block 1, block 2. Block 1 is present here, block 2 is present here. So map tasks will be executed by task trackers which are present here, right? Assume that while these task trackers are executing, assume that this task tracker somehow crashed. The job tracker will identify that this task tracker crashed. How will it identify? Task trackers will be sending heartbeats at regular intervals, right? So if my job tracker does not receive a heartbeat from task tracker, it will identify that the task tracker is down. And then what the task tracker will do is it will schedule the same map task in another task tracker. So the block 2 might be replicated on another data node, right? Maybe here. So on this node, the task tracker will execute the same map task again. So if one of the task tracker is down when the job is getting executed, my job will not fail. The job tracker will detect it and will try to execute the same task on another node. So can I say that my MapReduce is fault tolerant? Yes. So that's how the MapReduce is fault tolerant. And one more feature of MapReduce is like this. Suppose if the task trackers are running on these two machines, assume that this task tracker is running slowly because this machine is slow, or maybe due to various reasons this task tracker is running slowly. Job tracker will identify that this task tracker is running a bit slow, and what it will do is the job tracker will start the same task under another task tracker. Whichever task completes first, that output will be taken by job tracker, and the other task will be killed. Okay, so that means the job tracker is intelligent enough to identify the slowly running tasks, and the job tracker may schedule the same task on another node. Whatever completes first, that output will be taken. So this feature of MapReduce is called as speculative execution. Okay. So you need not worry, as a developer, you need not worry about all these things. You are abstracted from all these details as a developer. So as a MapReduce developer, what you do? You write your MapReduce programs either in Java, or even you can write MapReduce program in any language. There is something called as Hadoop streaming, which will allow to execute a MapReduce job which is written in either C++ or any other languages. So as a programmer, you will be writing MapReduce programs either in Java or in some other language. And you need not worry about all these internals, how to parallelize your jobs, how to distribute your jobs, how to make your jobs fault tolerant, you need not worry. MapReduce engine will take care of it. Developer can just concentrate on writing their map and reduce function logic. Okay? And one more feature of MapReduce is, MapReduce engine provides us some status monitoring tools. So let me discuss a brief on what is this tool. Let me log into my Hadoop, my machine, my master machine. I'll just log in. So on this master machine, are the processes running? Yes, they are running. So on this, what I will do is, I'll open my browser. You know that on master node, I can use a URL like this. One minute. Not responding, okay. Okay, I can use master colon 50070 is the port at which name node has started the HTTP server. 50070. So there's one more URL. I'll just give master colon 50030. 50030 is the port at which the job tracker runs a HTTP server. Oh, is my job tracker running? No. Oh, on my machine, actually, there are only HDFS daemons running. So if I want to start daemons for MapRed, start-mapred.sh. Let me start. Oh, MapRed, sorry. So job tracker and task tracker has started. Okay. Let me say JPS. Job tracker, has it started successfully? Yes. Now, once the job tracker daemon starts, it starts a HTTP server at 50030 by default. Let me refresh. I think it is taking some time. Yep. Yep. See? 50030, here the job tracker started a HTTP server, and we'll be able to see how many map tasks are running, how many reduce tasks are running, what is the status, everything, all the information about map reduce programs will be seen in this UI. So map reduce also provides us some tools for monitoring the jobs. So we'll come to this UI a little later, and we'll discuss about this UI in detail later. Right now, at a high level, understand that MapReduce also provides us status and monitoring tools. Okay, next. So this is a bigger picture of a MapReduce job. A map will work on each block present in the node. It will read the data and emit some key value pairs. So each map will be working on a particular block, and it will be emitting key value pairs. Now, after all the map tasks are executed, these key value pairs are given to shuffle and sort phase. Shuffle and sort. So during shuffle, all the values belonging to particular key are aggregated, and key comma list of all values are passed to reducers. By default, there will be one reducer, and of course we can configure n number of reducers. We will see that. So reducers will be given with key comma, the values, list of all values for that key. And finally, the reducers will write the final output. That will be the output of our MapReduce code. This is a bigger picture of MapReduce. We'll dig deep into each of the phase going on further. So coming to the discussion again, the MapReduce jobs are controlled by what? Job tracker. Job tracker resides on what? Master node. A client submits MapReduce jobs to job tracker, and job tracker is responsible for assigning map tasks and reduce tasks to cluster. So job tracker assigns these tasks to whom? Task tracker. task tracker is responsible for actually instantiating map task and reduce task, and task tracker is responsible for reporting the progress back to job tracker. This we already discussed. Next, this is a high level picture. Job tracker will be running on master machine. Job tracker will create the map tasks and reduce tasks and submit to task trackers. Task trackers will execute the tasks and report the status back to job tracker. In MapReduce, every input is a key value pair. So map gets the data as key value pair. By default, the key for a map will be the byte offset, and value will be the line of that file. Okay, so let's assume that this is the input. Okay, this is the input. What happens? The input file, let's assume that it is of size 150 MB, but in this example, assume that this line belongs to first block, second line belongs to second block, third line belongs to third block. Assume, just for imagination, okay? So for each block will be given to one mapper. How many mappers? 3 mappers. So the byte offset will become as a key to the mapper, and the total line will be the value. So after reading this line, what the mapper will may output? Key value pairs. Okay, so this is an example for word count. So I want to count how many times each word has occurred. So the input to the mapper will be key value pair. Okay, key is nothing but the byte offset. Most of the times in mapper, the key is ignored, and the value will be the content of the line. So by using that value, we are splitting the line and emitting word comma one. So the mapper will emit all these key value pairs. And during shuffling, what happens? All the keys whose value are same will be bought together. They are aggregated together. And then the output is sorted. During shuffle and sort, the output, the key value pairs are sorted based on keys. Then this key and values will be going to reducer. Reducer will be emitting the final output. The reducer will actually emit the count, how many times this word is occurring. Beer, 1 plus 1, 2. Car has occurred 3 times, 3. Deer. So like this, the output of reducer will be the final result. This is a simple word count example. So in MapReduce terminology, what is a job? Job is a full program. A complete execution of mappers and reducers over a data set is called as a job. What is the task? Execution of a single mapper or reducer is called as a task. So tasks can be divided into two types: map task, reduce task. And again, what is the task attempt? Task attempt is a particular instance of an attempt to execute a task. Attempt to execute a task is called as a task attempt. So who will do the task attempts? Task trackers will try to attempt to run a task, execute a task. Okay? So how many task attempts will be there? There will be at least as many task attempts as there are tasks. So if there are 3 map tasks and 2 reduced tasks, how many total tasks are there? 5. So there will be at least 5 attempts. It is possible that one of the task attempt may fail. In that case, what happens? Another task attempt is created by the job tracker. We understood about what is this speculative execution also earlier. Next, how to write a mapper? So if you want to write a mapper, simple, there is one old API and new API in Hadoop versions, old API and new API. This is the program which I'm showing is in old API. We'll see how to write a mapper in new API next. So according to old API, if you want to write your own mapper, you need to write a class extending MapReduceBase and implement mapper. Okay, so what is this? This is the key type I'm expecting for my mapper, and this is the value type I'm expecting for my mapper. So we can decide what is the key type expected and value type expected. We'll see about this later. And this is the key type which will be emitted by the mapper, and this will be the value type emitted by the mapper. So inside this mapper, there's only a one method map which we need to override. It is taking the input key and input value. So what will be the key? Suppose if my line is like this, hello Shiva, how are you? So this is a file. First time when the map method is called, one map method will be called for every line. Assume that my file is containing a single block, or let's say two blocks. Let's assume this block one and block two for simplicity. So in block one, there are number of lines. Each line, for each line, mapper.map will be called. Okay, so what will be the key? The byte offset. So here the byte offset for the first line will be 0. And how many letters are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. This is 12th letter. This H in second line is 12th letter. So 0 will be the key, and the line will be the value for the first time when mapper is called, for the first line. For second line, when the map method is called, the key will be long 12 and value will be the line content. So like that, by default, for a map method, the key will be the byte offset. Okay, later we'll see how to have a different keys as well, but by default the key will be of type long writable, and it is nothing but the byte offset for each line. Byte offset means which byte is it in the file, what is the byte number with which this line is starting. That's the byte offset. So my map method is taking key value, and output is there and reporter is there. As of now, don't worry about reporter, we'll see it next. What I am doing is, the value is nothing but the line, right? I'm getting the each line as a string, splitting the line by using for each word, and for each word what I'm doing, I'm saying output dot collect key. What is the key? The word, and value is 1. So if my first line is hello Shiva, how are you? So what will be the key value pairs which are emitted by this whole mapper after this line is executed? Hello 1, Shiva 1, how 1, are 1, you 1. So all like this key value pairs will be emitted by my mapper. Then this is how mapper is written, a simple mapper. Ignore about reporter. Reporter object can be used to pass some information back to the driver code. We'll see. We'll investigate on reporter later in the course. Then if you have to write your own reducer, how to write? You have to extend map reduce base and implement reducer interface. What is the key value pair expected for this? Key values expected for this reducer. Whatever map was emitting, that will be the key value pair for reducer. And what will the key value pair emitted by this reducer? These are the two things. So you need to understand clearly the output of mapper. What is it? Mapper is outputting text comma int writable. The output of mapper, the output types of mapper here, text comma int writable, will become input types for the reducer. So reduce method, if you see, it is taking one key and iterator of values, iterator for a list of values. So as I told, before reduce, there will be shuffle and sort. What the shuffle will do? It will gather the values for each key. For each key, there might be n number of values. So the key and list of all values as iterator will be passed. So what this reducer is doing is, it is iterating for each value. It is iterating for each value and getting each value, summing up all the values for that particular key and outputting key comma sum of all the counts. This is how a simple reducer is written. Then once we have a mapper and reducer, this is, we need to write one more code called as driver code, where we write a class containing main method. So for this main method, I am expecting two arguments. One is the input directory from which I need to take the input files, and one is output directory where the output of reducer should be written. So here what I am doing is, I am creating a job configuration object, job conf, okay, job conf we are creating, and we are giving a job name, some name we can give, and for this job configuration, we need to set the input paths. To set the input paths, we need to do like this. We'll see about what is file input format and what is file output format a little later. What you are doing, file input format dot set input paths, you are passing the conf object and arg0, I'm expecting what, input directory, the directory from which I need to take the input files, and file output format dot set output path, and again I'm passing conf. So actually this static methods will be using this conf object to set the input path and output path. So once the input path and output path is set, we are saying conf.setMapper class. What is my mapper class? Word mapper, whichever I have written. Set reducer class, some reducer, whatever I have written. Set map output key class. What is the output key of mapper? What is the output value class for mapper? Similarly, what is output key for reducer? What is output key for output value for reducer? I have to set. And then how to submit this job to job tracker? We use an object called as job client. Job client dot run job. And I'm passing the configuration. So once you call this run job method, this job configuration is submitted to job tracker. Okay. This is how we should write the driver code. So let me show you the same code on my virtual machine. We'll try to execute it. So in my Eclipse, already I have this code. So I have this project called as zero to map reduce, and here is a word count solution. Basically, what I want to do, I want to count the number of words in a given file. Very simple and basic example. So here I have already created, this is not required as of now. I have written my mapper. This is my mapper, word mapper, extending map reduce base. Key is long writable for my mapper. Value is, expected input value is of type text. My mapper will emit text comma int writable. Same thing, whatever I have shown in my presentation, it is same thing. and this is my reducer, whatever I have shown in my presentation. So then here is the driver code. Driver is nothing but a class which contains main method and which submits the job configuration to job tracker. Any class which creates the job configuration object and submits the job configuration to job tracker is a driver class, we say. Here is the same driver class which I have shown in my presentation. So here I will use file output format. We'll see the importance of those output formats and input formats next. So now how to run this? What I will do is I'll go to my workspace. And my project name is what? 01 word count solution. 01 word count solution target classes. So I have to create a jar. Jar dash CVF. What? Word count dot jar, whatever I want the jar file name. Space star. So whatever is present in this directory, it will be written into a jar. Hope you know how to create a jar. I'll clear it. ls. There is a word count jar. Now how to submit this jar file? How to execute a MapReduce job? Now there's a command called as Hadoop, which we used earlier. Hadoop fs. Hadoop space fs is the one which you use for firing some file system related commands. If you want to run MapReduce jobs, Hadoop jar, I need to write Hadoop jar and 1 minute. Okay. Hadoop jar, and what is the jar name? Word count dot jar, and in that, what is the class? What is the driver class name? In dot co dot way to learn dot word count. This is a driver class name. Space. What is the location? Which should be the input directory? First, let me check. In my HDFS, is there any folder where I can give as input? I'm opening another terminal and I'll say Hadoop fs-ls/user/siva. I think there is Shakespeare folder which I created earlier. Let me check. Yep, Shakespeare is there. And all the demos are running, right? Yes. So I will give the input directory as /user/siva/Shakespeare. And output, I want to be in a folder /user/siva/word count out. This folder will be automatically created. So let me run this. So it is printing how many total paths to be processed. Actually, under Shakespeare folder, there are 5 files. So total input paths is 5. And you can see that job client is running the output. Job client is printing the status map. Map percentage is 0 and reduce percentage 0. So how is the job client getting the status? The task trackers will be giving the status to job tracker, and job tracker will be giving the job status to job client, as we have discussed earlier. So this will take some time to complete MapReduce jobs. I will just pause my videos until the jobs are completed. So the mapper, the map reduce job is completed. Once the map reduce job is completed, we'll see the, while it is running, we'll see the percentage of maps and reduces. And after all the map reduce is completed, it will finally print some status. How many map tasks were executed? 7. How many data local map tasks? 7. So all the information will be returned to here and we'll see the outputs. Now let us see the outputs. Where are the outputs? I gave my output should be written to where? user/siva/word_cnt_out. I will show you the outputs in the browser. So here is browse file system. I'll click on it. Then /user/siva/word_cnt_out. So in the output folder, if there is a file called as success, that means the job is success. If the job has failed, you will see a failure file. Actually, this file is not containing anything. This file indicates that the job has been successfully executed. And there's a logs directory where you can find the logs written by the task trackers. Okay, so we'll see logs later. Now let us see the output of reducer. I'll come back to this word count out. See, there is a file called as part-000. The size is 317 KB. So this file is written to HDFS. The output of reducer also is written to HDFS. So let me open this file. See here, it is returning. Aaron has occurred 72 times. Abate has occurred once. The word count, right? So for each word, the count is written back to this file system. Remember, the output of reducer is returned to the file system inside some output directory. The output file will be somehow like this, part-some_number. We'll be discussing about various output file names, what are the possibilities, while discussing the next concepts. So this is the output. Okay, so what has happened? When I ran this program, I am running job client dot run. So this job client is an object which represents the Hadoop client. So what has happened? See this diagram. 1 minute. See this diagram as I explained earlier. So the job client object represents this client. So job client has submitted the jar to job tracker. Job tracker has identified how many blocks are present, because while the client is submitting to job tracker, it will create input splits corresponding to each block. So in my for my for my program, how many files were there in Shakespeare folder? In Shakespeare folder there are 5 files, but there is one big file which is in 2 blocks. So there are totally how many input splits? 7 input splits. Let me quickly show you here. Inside Shakespeare folder, see, all files are small, but there is, oh, all the files are in MBs only. Okay, so how many blocks are there for this file? 1 block, 1 block, 1 block, 1 block, 5 blocks. Yes, 5 blocks are there. So how many input splits? 5 input splits. So 5 input splits are created by the job client, and then the job jar as well as this list of input splits is given to job tracker. For each input split, one map task is created, and map tasks are submitted to task trackers. Task trackers are responsible for starting a map task, and for each line in the file, input file, mapper object dot map will be called. Mapper dot map will be called. Map method is called for each line, and what we are doing, we are splitting the line and then for each word I am outputting one. So mapper will output key value pairs, is it? So coming to the presentation, in my example, yep, see, so for the map every line will be the input, the mapper will output deer 1, beer 1, river 1, like that the keys will be emitted by each mapper, each mapper. So in this case I am assuming that one line is equivalent to one block, just assuming, okay. So one mapper has executed this and the mapper has outputted this key value pairs, right? And after shuffle phase, during shuffle phase, all the keys with same value are brought together, and this is beer is brought together, car is brought together, deer and river. Then key comma list of values is passed to reducer. For reducer, what is the input? Key comma list of values. So for mapper, key comma value, and for reducer, key comma iterator of values. So my reducer is computing the sum of each values for a key. For each value it is iterating and computing the sum and writing, this is writing the word count. So this is the driver. The driver, in the driver we have to create a job configuration object, set the input paths. I'm taking the arg0 from command line as input, and arg1 is nothing but output directory. Setting the mapper class, reducer class, map key type, value type, reducer key type and value type, and then job client.run job will submit my job configuration to job tracker. That's how it works. So I have given a high level overview of how a mapper and reducer will work. Now in the lab documentation there is 04, this documentation is there. Just open this documentation, okay, and in this documentation clearly step by step I have given what has to be done, okay. So in this lab documentation you have to complete up to up to this one. So you have to complete this whole documentation, you just have to run. Here you will see how to run a job and how to kill a job also I have given clearly one by one. So first, before going through the next video, make sure that you do the lab documentation. The lab documentation is having some extra information also, okay. Please go ahead with the documentation. Just seeing the videos may not help. The documentation is written very nicely. Please go through the documentation and complete it. Meet you in the next video, and we'll be discussing more in depth about MapReduce. Still there are lots of topics in MapReduce. We'll discuss them in detail in my next videos.